Good evening. My name is Jay Rothman, and welcome to Real People, Real Stories Raw. This is a Sunday edition, and on this special edition today, I am going to be doing a show solo. Usually, Debbie joins me in a studio, but she took a day off, a much-needed day of rest for herself to do some self-care. And so Nancy and I decided to come on and do the show, and so I'd like to introduce my guest this afternoon. Her name is Nancy Nance Chaplin. Welcome to the studio and welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's an honor. It's exciting. I'm here in a foreign country doing something I've never done before. So there's stepping out of your comfort zone and then there's leaping with faith. So,
beautiful. Yeah. Beautiful. What I'd like to do is if I've tagged you on the live so that it should show up on your feed. So you should be good as far as anyone that is following you that wants to watch the show live. From what I understand, first of all, I'd like to welcome those that are live with us, watching the show live. If you're with us, thank you so much. As we progress into the show, if you hear something that you like or love and it resonates with you, please push gently with love and kindness, your love and like button. And if something resonates, you have any questions or comments, feel free to just share away. And we'll do our best to respond or during the show or there's time that shortly thereafter. I'd like to welcome Bronnie Fisher coming in from Australia. We've got Gabrielle Schneider coming in. Debbie Garcia is coming in from Los Angeles. Debbie is the founder of Spirituality Gone Wild, the channel that we're coming in live from today. So welcome, Debbie. And so glad you and I had a chance to connect earlier this morning and have a great conversation. Linda Shoup, good afternoon. And Robert Dosa, thank you for joining us live. And so, from my understanding, you actually live up in Edmonton, Alberta?
Yep, up in Canada, Edmonton, Alberta, where there's lots of snow, and I'm not there.
And so you are coming in live from a beautiful part of Mexico, from what I understand. Is that right?
Yeah, I'm in Puerto Aventuras. So Puerto Aventuras is down from Playa del Carmen, and up from Tulum, and I'm here with my parents.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah. Ralph and I come up here every year. It's our special place.
We love it.
It's a beautiful, beautiful community of people. And then we tour around from here to check out different places. Something new.
Awesome.
Yeah.
How's it been so far on this trip?
Oh, it's been great. We spent 5 days up in Merida, which is somewhere that we'd never been before. And even though there were warnings not to go there, we followed our hearts instead of the news reports. And we went to the absolute friendliest city that I have ever been in Mexico before. And Merida was simply magical. I've never experienced such kindness in a city in Mexico before. So thumbs up for Merida. Yeah, it was great. It was
awesome.
Great. Yeah.
Well, I'd like to just share with the community and with you, Nancy, that this is a safe zone. And what I mean by that is I work really hard to create a safe environment for you. And if at any time if I'm to ask you a question that you're uncomfortable with or that triggers you in any way, you can say to me, I'm just not comfortable sharing. We just never know. Yeah. But in any event, I want to just acknowledge and thank you for joining us live today, coming in from Mexico on your time off, on your vacation, to do the show. And so with that, I know very little about you. And so I'm going to hear for the first time your story, as well as everyone that's watching us live or on replay.
Right. Well, you know, I am Nancy Nance, and I also am Exponential Joy. And exponential is something that is a great big word. So most people don't even understand what that means. But I learned in my recovery from grief, from a tremendous amount of trauma in my life, that emotions have power. And they calibrate. And they calibrate by the power of 10. So it's going way back to junior high math, where you've got 20 to the power of 10. 20 times 20 times 20 times 20 times 20 all the way up to 10. And it's a relatively large number. But that's shame. Shame is the lowest vibration that we've got for an emotion. And how often are we there? And how often do we put others there? We do it by instinct. We've been programmed. And this beautiful mind that we've got absorbs all that information. And we just keep on doing it and keep on doing it, and it becomes a pattern. So we have it done and we do it to others. Like, oh, Jay, how could you have done that? You should have been more careful. And as soon as we articulate those words, should, I should have, you should have, we're shaming. And the other person feels guilt, which is just a little bit higher up. And so many of us are in that heavy, heavy state of destructive emotion. And that's where we stay and we suffer and we suffer and we stay. But then we can move up to apathy. And apathy is the place where we see on the homeless, on the streets of Calcutta, the streets of Edmonton, the streets of Toronto, the streets of Mexico, where we don't feel that we have a home. And we don't feel welcome in this world. And it's a very, very, very destructive state of being. And I was there. I didn't feel like I belonged to so much of my life. And I tried so hard to fit in. So I was the good girl. I was the good girl. I was the good mother. I was the good daughter. I was the good wife. I took very good care of everybody else so that they would love me. And I could prove to the world that I was doing a good job. But I wasn't really living. And life is a series of choices. We're expanding or we're contracting. And on the inside, I was staying really, really small. On the outside, I was doing great because I was serving cookies, wonderful dinners. I was smiling. I was happy all the time. How are you? I'm good. I'm good. How are you? And I wouldn't really talk about myself other than trivial conversation. And as I was recovering from the trauma of losing a child, I stayed in apathy and guilt, tremendous amount of guilt from losing a child, because we naturally blame ourselves. If only. And we go through the list of things that I could have, should have, would have done. But I didn't want to live that way. I wanted to have joy in my life. My daughter's middle name was Joy. And when I lost her, I realized that I was living my life for her. I was looking forward to graduation. I was looking forward to going to college together, going to university, because I didn't have that in my life. I had children young, but we were going to do it together. And then I would be okay. And I wasn't very good at just me. I didn't know how to care just for myself. And then I went past that fear of what would everybody think. Stepping out of that comfort zone where the imagination is like, you can't do that, you can't do this. Because when we go through trauma and we go through loss, and there's that smack in life where something goes wrong, we suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder. And when my daughter passed, the sirens, the flashing lights, she was killed in a boating accident. And when I came on the scene of the accident and I saw those lights and I heard those noises, I could never be in an environment like this. There was no way. And I didn't look for healers. Healers came to me. I had a friend who did Reiki, and she just came over and she just sat there, and I had no idea what she was doing, but I felt better when she was around. And I entered a state of desire where I wanted to know what that was. I wanted a taste from that bottle, a taste from that wine. I wanted more. And I didn't only want it for everybody else. I was still in codependency, so if I took Reiki, I could help my entire family. But then I discovered I had to help me first. That was strange, and that was difficult. when I went through my training and I had to only work on myself for 21 days, that was more difficult for me than going through recovery from addictions. Stopping using crack cocaine was a piece of cake compared to taking care of myself, and only myself, for 21 days. Man, that was like a rehab I'd never experienced before. But I felt a calm and a peace. There wasn't noise anymore. I could be in a place where there were hundreds of people, but my mind was clear, and it was the most beautiful feeling that I ever experienced, and I wanted more. So I have an insatiable desire for learning. So I would investigate, and if it worked for me, I certified in it. I certified in a lot. I learned that if I was to take care of others, I could only do it from a full cup. And I filled what I called my joy bucket. And I just kept on learning. I became more powerful. And I realized that a lot of voices in my head were from something outside of myself. And I realized that it was angels talking to me. And that's when everything really shifted, because then the life that I lived and the people that I resonated with, I separated from. And that was scary, to leave what I was comfortable with and move towards something that was very different, and to trust in a power that was greater than myself, especially a power that at one time I believed had taken my daughter from me, because my faith was tested, and I hated God, and I blamed Jesus. Like, we were done. We were finished. How dare you do that to me? I trusted you. And I didn't realize that life was working for me and not against me. It was always working for me if I was doing what came naturally for me. I was in accounting for 25 years and I was good at it, but I hated what I did. And through a series of medical events, seemingly random events, I fell down the stairs, I ratcheted my shoulder, and I had bursitis so bad that I had to use the calculator with my left hand. And I did, because I wasn't going to give up. But then I went through abusive work relationship after abusive work relationship until I landed myself in a situation where I had cluster migraines for 145 days. And the universe said, no, you cannot continue any further. And I was forced to leave the profession that I was so comfortable in and choose to do what I loved to do. And it was a risk. And a lot of people warned me, you'll never make it. That's not a real job. Nobody would hire you. You don't have the skills. But I did. I did. I had certifications that I kept quiet, my dirty little secret. And I didn't tell anybody that I'd certified in Reiki. I just did it as a hobby. I did EFT as a hobby for myself. I tapped and I tapped and I tapped until every single fear was gone. And life just started falling into place. I started studying the laws of attraction, and I read every single book that Esther wrote. I watched every DVD. I took notes and I practiced. And I manifested things into my life. A dear friend of mine often says, Nance and her purple crayon. Because I would imagine what I wanted, and I would imagine it in detail, and then it would appear. I manifested the man of my dreams. I was praying. I didn't believe too much, like I said, in Jesus. But archangels were okay. I could trust these guys. And I was praying to the Archangel Raphael. And I wrote a list of all the things I didn't want, because that was clear. And then I just took it and I reversed it. So I knew that I wanted someone who was trustworthy, dependable, honest, that it had a sense of humor and a spontaneity, but they were wrapped in honor. Someone that honored my children. I have four sons, and I wanted someone that would be a mentor and a guide, but a friend, not a parent. And I created a vision board, and I went online. And then my dear friend, I went over to her house, and she was looking over my profile, and she found this bald guy. And I'm like, no, not the bald guy, right? Because he was bald, tropical backdrop, so had to be in the army, right? Aren't all bald guys in the army? And I didn't want to know. I know.
Not I.
I didn't want to have somebody that was going to come back from war and be broken, because I'd already fixed myself and I didn't want to do it again. And I couldn't imagine having someone in my life that was forced to do things that they didn't do, that they didn't want to do. It, mm-hmm. it couldn't possibly be. So she liked the bald guy, and I'm like, nah, not the bald guy. So I went into her kitchen and poured myself a glass of wine, it was a glass, and I'm talking with her dogs. I love talking to animals because I do healing on animals as well. I hear them all the time. It's beautiful. And then my phone made this really strange shine, and I didn't know what it was, so I started looking, and the match.com icon had a notification, so I clicked on it, and oh my God, the bald guy was on my phone. And I went in, and she'd been liking all of his pictures, and he thought it was me. I responded the next day to his message, hey you, with a simple hey back. And I wanted a friend, and we became the dearest of friends. And there's no doubt in anybody who knows us of how beautiful our meaning to be together is, because we live more than one life. We live more than one life because we wake up every day and we got a past life because it was over there. But we live multitudes of past lives. We are energy, and energy does not die. Because if I turn off this computer, you're still here. We just can't see each other anymore. And I learned that life sometimes may feel like it's breaking you down, but it's just breaking through the walls on your heart so that you can shine again, because we are all beautiful light beings and we all can heal. I do not believe that there is one person on this earth that cannot heal. And as we got to know each other, and I found out his name was Ralph, like my grandfather, but he was actually Raphael. I kind of went, whoa, that's kind of interesting. And then we'd been dating for a few months. He'd made me breakfast, so I wanted to make him breakfast. I opened up the fridge, bachelor fridge, eggs, bread, butter, green apples, and coconut. What else does a single man need? And I made breakfast. But as I closed the door, I noticed on the front, there was a magnet, and it said, Brenda's Kitchen. Friends always welcome. And I'm like, okay, this is messed up. And I went in, and I gave him his coffee, and I asked him who Brenda was. And he's like, yeah. I didn't quite know how to bring that up, because I'd used Brenda in a very derogatory term, because my ex-husband left me for a woman whose name was Brenda. It's just a name, but it had a strong connection. That was his wife's name as well. And I found out months later that my father left my mother for a woman whose name is Brenda. There's synchronicity in life.
Wow.
And sometimes we see it and sometimes we don't. Then I was blessed with the opportunity from Daphne, dear friend of mine, Daphne McDonough, Daphne's Healing Hands. I wear her jewelry everywhere I go because crystals help me detach at times from other people's energies. And she said to me, you got to write a chapter for this book. And she didn't stop. So I said, if I write it, will you stop? She says, yes. So she sent me an email, or she contacted the lady who was putting together this book. And an email, a series of emails came through, and I just noticed the one, because I'm like, Brenda, why would Brenda be sending me an email? But I realized it was the woman who was compiling stories, and that this was my opportunity to heal and to understand that these women were just beautiful angels in my life who were teaching me lessons. Forgiveness, betrayal, unconditional love. We are all just humans being and doing. And we all make mistakes, because I've made mine. I've gone through the 12 steps and I continue to go through them as I work on forgiveness. Forgiveness to myself for the people that I've caused harm to, and to those who have caused me harm. And every single day when I get a trigger, because we all get triggers, there isn't one day that's perfect. I know that there's healing that needs to be done within me. And now I'm able to help other people uncover what it is in their lives that they can choose to work on. And if they are willing, healing is possible at all times of your life. Even times whereby you can't even see the possibility because you have a terminal disease. And healing is not possible as long as your heart is beating. Healing is possible. my dear friend Fabrizio, this is his restaurant, and it's always the best pizza in town, as well as a gentle hand from a loving man. I had to learn to love men. When you go through divorce, whether you're a
wow, synchronicity. We just lost Nancy. I'm sure she'll pop back on. This is definitely one of the challenges when we come in from overseas. Today, she's coming in from Mexico, and she knew she had some spotty Wi-Fi connections. I believe she's popping in right now. She'll be back in the studio. She's showing up in the lobby.
All those negative emotions, right? Oh no, she cut the internet off. But we do, we go through, we're all humans. I filled over 20 journals as I plotted revenge. It's my truth.
Hey, lost reception.
I'm back. I'm back. I plotted revenge. My doctor was concerned after the death of my daughter. Are you depressed? I was sad. I was very, very, very sad. I was a consumer of marijuana in Canada long before it was legal. And it was what helped me. Because I wasn't suicidal, but I was honestly filled with such a deep hatred that I would have been considered homicidal if I'd acted on anything that I felt. I blamed so many people in my life for the trauma and the tragedy because I didn't see that life was working for my healing, because our life is a healing journey every single day. As we peel back the layers, because every time we get hurt, we protect ourselves and we protect ourselves. And we're going to deal with it later and later. Now is the day. Today is the day. and every day just for today. Just for today is such a beautiful phrase. And alcoholics use it, drug addicts use it. And then I found out that it's a Reiki as well. Just for today, I will not be angry. And then I started keeping track of when I was angry. And I kept score, for and against. And then anger changed to irritation. And it just dissuaded. Sometimes I would feel hurt. But people are people, and they're going through their journeys too. And it wasn't all about me. I realized it wasn't all about me. And in helping other people, I always help myself. Because we're attracted to people that are going through similar journeys as we are. Compassion, empathy, unconditional love. Those are aspirations. And when we are there, there's nothing that we can't create. When we start looking at life with hope and optimism, courage, happiness, and joy and peace, not all day, but moments where we can feel that we are a part of everything, man, 5 minutes of meditation is better than 5 hours of medication.
I want to just take a moment to pause and ask you to just take a deep breath and allow yourself just to feel what you're feeling in this moment. And I'd like to ask you a couple of questions. One is, it's very apparent that you've come a long way in your healing process. And one of the challenges that most people face when they've hit some type of rock bottom for themselves, whatever their backstory is like, we have a very traditional way of thinking our belief systems, at least in North America, is we always run to go to seek counsel, is where we start. And so I'm curious, from your perspective, what didn't work for you, or when did it start to work? Because I can't imagine that out of the gate you are on this healing journey that kind of led you to where you are, without a point feeling like you're not making progress. Like, what am I doing? I mean, we heard that last Sunday with Lisa, that she spent a couple of decades, or at least one decade, just putting on that facade like everything was okay. But she was still dying inside, even though she was on this healing journey. Because she was just doing self-help books and highlighting them and doing the things that she believed was what her belief system was. And she wasn't in North America. She's coming in from England, London area. And so I'm just curious, you know, for you, what was your path? And what was the shift? What was the game changer for you?
Changer for me was when I was finding that nobody knew my journey. And though people came at me with the most wonderful amount of good wishes, it was when I learned that I shouldn't do anything. You should do this and you should do that. I'd gone to a counselor's meeting. I'd gone to a psychologist, and it was part of the agreement when I ended, when my husband and I ended our relationship. And he gifted to me a sessions with a psychiatrist. And she asked me a simple question, but I didn't have the answer. And she said, what would you like to do? What would would you wake up to do every single day that would bring you happiness and joy? And at the time, I said, well, I really enjoy yoga. And when I wake up in the morning, I know that I can do that. And then she said, can you do that for the rest of your life? And I wasn't sure about the rest of my life. I said, no. How about for the 5-year plan, the 3-year plan? Like, no. And I said, but you know what? I feel comfortable with 3 months. She said, okay, that's where you are at. And she worked with me in a way that was just for me. And I began to listen to the guidance of others, but make my own decisions. And I realized that a lot of people have wonderful intentions as they give unsolicited advice. But if we aren't willing to go for help, then we're not ready. But if we're ready and somebody is able to love us and accept us and see that untapped potential. And I love taking children back, children, you, everybody, back into their childhood, to that place where they had something that they were so excited about. What did you want to do when you grew up? Well, I wanted to have a family. And to help them understand why. What is it about family that makes you happy? And to help them understand their emotions. I pull a lot of modalities in when I do a healing. I have fun. I've got angel cards. I've got emotion cards. I've got bags filled with colors that you can't see. Because there's a powerful force that can help us. So you pick a bag off the table. There's 7 bags. You pick a bag and there's one that has a color in it. It's a color of a chakra. What's in the bag? That's where we begin. And it's a fun way of coming at therapy. Life can be too serious. And I love the storyline from Batman and the Joker. Why so serious? Because when we come into something like counseling or therapy, there's the assumption that we're broken. And no one's broken. We're just a little bit bent. We're just a little bit bent. And everything heals. Absolutely everything heals. And the body has this incredible ability. I mean, I don't tell my skin to heal, but it does. And when we start creating with nature instead of against nature, man, the body. I mean, I am an aromatherapy enthusiast. I've got that stuff everywhere. Right before I got on here, I couldn't get the connection. We were running behind. Dinner was late, and all I had was a little bottle of frankincense. A little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit here. Oh. No side effects. There's cautions. But it's nature.
What did the frankincense do for you in a moment? Did it relax you or keep you calm?
Frankincense for me calms everything along here. The areas where I used to tense because I got mad. And I mean, anybody that knows Nance before she was the Nance that she is, man, I could empty a bar room. I mean, I was like, I had a right and a left, and I was very aggressive. I I always had my hands clenched. And the many healing modalities, as well as frankincense, just helped me find those heavy points, and they soften. And everything just starts to open. Because when your throat is tense and you can't breathe, everything just starts to lighten. But yet, I feel completely grounded and strong and secure in my own being. Because I'm perfectly imperfect in everything that I do, and I'm constantly growing. Perfectly imperfect. All these cells change every single day. And I've never been healthier in my entire life. I still have dis-ease in my body. But I have a condition that's called adenomyosis. So adenomyosis is when you have endometriosis and the lining of your uterus doesn't discard every month when you have your monthly period. And mine kept on staying and staying and staying until it wrapped around my entire uterus and was constricted in absolute pain. It was for 10 days before my period, 10 days of my period, and 7 to 10 days after. That was all month. And the only option that the medical system could give me was a complete hysterectomy. I'm 49 years old. I didn't want my body to lose a vital organ that it still needs. Because if it didn't need it, it wouldn't be working anymore. Now here I am, pain-free. I made a choice. And the medicine that I help people with is complementary medicine. I work with your doctor. I work with your chiropractor. I work with them all. Because we need both sides. We need diagnosis. We need surgery. And we need pharmaceuticals. But what about everything in between? All these beautiful plants around us. Flower essences. Aromatherapy. There's just this vast amount that's available to us. If you're simply willing to try. Nevertheless, I am willing. You know, the most valuable lesson that I ever learned was to never lie to myself. And if in my gut I knew that this didn't feel right, and if my heart felt uncomfortable, I didn't just say yes because that's what a doctor told me. I looked at other ways, and then I consulted with my doctor, and unfortunately my family doctor didn't know a lot about aromatherapy or flower essences. So I made a choice, and I chose to study. I chose to study for, 7 years now. Anybody who knows me knows my library, and it's that high. Because I don't just take knowledge from one book or one author. I cross-reference, and I cross-reference, and I cross-reference to ensure that what I'm doing for myself is healthy before I would ever offer to anybody else.
Yeah. Yeah, that's where we're aligned there. That's something I had to make some choices just over 3 years ago. Do I want to stay in the Western treatment plan, or am I willing to consider alternatives? And I, up until that point, I had no idea that there were alternatives, because that's not the world I came from.
I didn't know.
But for those that are not familiar with what frankincense is, that's an essential oil. It's one of the powerhouses. It's one of the more expensive ones that you could purchase, for sure.
They gave it to Jesus when he was born.
Yeah.
And you know, it's a really interesting fact. Frankincense, myrrh, and gold. But it wasn't heavy metal gold. Oh, if memory serves me correct, it was sweet basil. Because that was considered more valuable than gold. It was three essences. Mm-hmm. And yet we are still searching for gold.
Yeah.
You know, it can bring, irritable bowel syndrome can get such relief from aromatherapy. Muscles after you work out. I mean, I'm walking 10 to 15K every single day. And I put on my essential oils. I've got a special blend that I use while I'm on vacation. And it's got over 38 essential oils in it.
Are you DTERRA or are you with Young Living?
I am with a male.
I've never heard of him.
AMEO.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I did a blind study. See, I don't buy into things because when you make a series of choices that are not in your best interest, you become a little bit more skeptical, reserved. So I took 4 essential oils and I made a blend with 4 oils in it. I chose Abundance Blend is what my friend Daphne and I use. And it has vetiver, Atlas Cedarwood, patchouli, and ginger. So I took these 4 essential oils and I created with 4 different essential oil companies. And I gave them to 6 friends. They came back and they chose 2. So I took those 2, made them again in different colored bottles. I'm a scientist at heart. So I gave them these 2 bottles and I asked them to simply tell me which bottle made them feel better. They all came back with a male. And it's not the only oil that I use. Young Living has some blends that I really enjoy. Blends are wonderful, especially when you travel. Because, I mean, I've got a case of over 60 essential oils. I choose not to carry them all with me on vacation. So I choose to bring my frankincense and some blends.
Beautiful.
Peppermint. I always carry peppermint.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. I'd like to shift gears a little bit and kind of go back on a few things that I kind of just have stayed with me. One is you mentioned that you and your husband got a divorce. Did you go through that after your daughter passed away or before?
It was after my daughter passed away. We had 2 very strong belief systems that were very different. And we were mountains apart in our thoughts. And neither one of us were willing to change. And we'd been like that for a long time. It wasn't as though our life as a married couple was mutually respectful. We were both mutually mean. And the one thing that I learned, I always said it to my children, and then my children said it back to me, was a very beautiful phrase. Say what you mean.
Mean what you say. And don't say it mean.
And the children, the father of my children, my ex-husband, and I could no longer honor that. And we were both vicious. And I was far from the best version of myself. And, okay. You know, a good codependent never leaves. So he was the one that made the choice. But I knew it was coming. I'd left a little bit before, then he'd left me and I'd left him, and we did the dance.
Okay.
For years.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. Yeah. I appreciate that. You know, one other question I have for you that's really just staying with me is, when do you think the codependency came from? What was the root cause of that?
Oh gosh, you know, it was the way that I understood what I was told as a child before I had cognitive thought. So a good girl, a good wife, a good mother. A good girl does as she's told. So it was the way that I misconstrued and misunderstood what that was. And, you know, when we are in a codependent relationship, it's about putting other people before ourselves. And that's what I was taught to do. I was raised in a European family where the men ate first, then the children, then the women. that was the German way. And I started questioning that when I was 13. 13 was the year that Nance, good girl gone wild. And my mom sent me to my dad's house. You know, if you think the grass is greener on the other side, boy, I learned a lot of lessons that year. But I was taught to take care of others before myself. I was taught to, if it was my birthday, everybody else got a piece of cake before me. That was the tradition.
Okay. Thank you for sharing that. I also would like to take a moment to honor you for coming on today and being so so present and so available and so authentic in sharing what you have shared about your life. I appreciate you for that. And I thank you for coming on today. We have about 10 minutes left. And what I'd like to do is just throw out a few more questions for you, and then we'll go from there. Where are you today in your codependent behaviors and in the process of shifting or changing so that you no longer behave in a codependent way?
No. Okay, ask that question again. You broke up, sweetheart.
I said, where are you at today as it relates to codependency and your old codependent behaviors and thought patterns? Where are you in your journey as it relates to codependency?
Now in my journey as a codependent, I ask myself if the choices that I'm making, are they honoring us both? Are they honoring us both? Because quite often in codependency, we go from caring about ourselves, but in a very, now it's about me. And I wanted to be very careful that my relationships were about us and that they were mutually respectful. Because my journey and your journey are different 10,000 ways. And I mean, I may have lost a child, you may have lost a child, you may have gone through divorce, I may have gone through divorce. But our journeys are so incredibly different. And I have no right to tell you what to do. I can offer loving guidance if I'm asked. If I'm not asked, quite often I will say, oh, that's interesting. I don't have to agree, but I choose to be kind.
Do you see yourself as still being codependent, or do you think that you have healed from that addiction or that disease?
Well, I don't pick up the phone every single day and call my kids to make sure that they're okay. I wait for them to call me. And that was something that was very difficult for me as I struggled with the PTSD. Because if I heard a fire engine or if I heard that there was an accident in a city near them, and I mean, when I say near them, I mean, I lived in Edmonton, they were living in Kelowna and every possible way across Canada, if there was a tragedy, just a quick little text message, hey honey, how's it going? So over-concerned for others. There's love and there's concern.
Yeah.
But over concern. Over concern. Yeah.
Well, for good reason. I mean, you've gone through one of the worst tragedies that any parent can go through. And you know, I've met so many moms and dads that have lost children to addiction in the 12-step rooms that I attended for codependency challenges that I had in my life. And
and you know what, and it's still happening. It's still happening. I mean, within the last 2 months, I think they're within, I have four sons and many, many children who call me mom or Auntie Nance. And there has been at least 6 suicides in the last 3 months that are drug, alcohol, abuse related. And to help these parents connect with their children and to help them move forward in life when their feet feel like they are in quicksand and they know how. To give them options and tools. And I mean, I give options and tools, and I give homework. I give homework. When you have a session with me, you end up with about a 6-page email with suggestions.
Nancy, you're coming in very, very badly right now. Can you hear me, Nancy? I'm going to drop you off in the lobby and I'll have you come back in. You can hear me?
Okay.
I'm going to drop you off and I'll pick you right back up. Well, as you could hear, Nancy was coming in very, very poorly. She's coming in from Mexico while she's on vacation. And so I decided to take her out of the studio, bring her back in the lobby, but now it looks like she's lost total reception. We'll see if she makes it back on. Hopefully she will. Here she comes. You know, I'm
getting good at this.
Yeah, you know, yeah, you are getting good at this. But, you know, what's beautiful about this moment is that when I first started doing the shows and we'd have technical difficulties and things like this would happen. And we've got people coming in from all over the globe, all over the world. And sometimes connections are really bad. Yeah. I used to get so stressed out and like so such anxiety over it. And now it's like part of the growth is just accepting that, you know, it just happens the way it happens. And if it meant that you were going to be gone for the rest of the show, then that's how it was supposed to end. And it's about just accepting.
And that maybe there's another opportunity.
Exactly.
Maybe.
So I have one last question for today to honor your time. As we're approaching the hour, we may go over a few minutes if that's okay with you. But the question that resonates with me right now is you clearly shared that at one point you were very, very angry at God, but you were accepting of the angels in your life. Where are you today with your relationship with God or higher power or Jesus or however you refer to your God?
Yeah, no, and that's an interesting one. You know, there's so many beautiful words that describe it, and divine healing intelligence resonates well with me, as well as unconditional love. And you know, when people talk to me about what that is, I relate to a mom. I love my children. I love them so very, very, very much. And I know that there is nothing that they can do that I would not forgive them for. And that I will help them, I will guide them, but it's up to them. They've got free will. And I know that it's the same with that divinity as well. My faith is very, very strong. It is non-dogmatic. I know that I am not going to get struck down by lightning, nor am I going to be punished. Life isn't punishment. Life is opportunity. And divinity is love. So maybe Bob Marley said it best when he said, love is my religion. You know, I refer to Jesus as Jay, you know, just Jay, because he's my friend. And when we can start looking at each and every person as a reflection of that, we're all the uncarved block. And we all have this unlimited, powerful potential. And right now in my life, what I'm working continuously on is forgiveness. And the fact that you're wearing a t-shirt that says choose forgiveness. I don't have a perfect life. I still have those in my life that are very aggressive towards me. People in my life who are not loving and respectful. But I can choose to be loving and respectful. Often to myself, which means I will not engage until I can find a way to engage with love. So divinity is love, and it's in all of us. It just needs to open up like a flower. That's all.
It's funny you said that about forgiveness, because that was going to be my last question to you. Where are you in the forgiveness spectrum today for yourself and for and towards others that have, you know, that you have been hurt by?
When I get frustrated, that's when the newfie girl comes out of me and I say, Lord, tender in Jesus. And then I work really hard. I work diligently. I work with determination. And I journal, and I pull out the paper, and I write, and I write, and I write. And I write as though I am talking to someone who is going to show me all the answers soon. Because it's in God time, which is good time. Patience. Patience. When you've been hurt by somebody, I don't believe that you can be hurt like this and forgive like this. It takes time. And as those memories come back and those triggers happen, because when you, those who have gone through the addiction understand what a trigger is. So when you're looking for that relief from something that hurts, that's when the opportunity presents itself. And I've got memories that are repressed that I'm shocked sometimes when they come back. Times in my adolescence, early years of my marriage, where I'm like, wow, man, I'm almost 50. And I'm remembering stuff when I was 15 that I'd forgotten. That's an opportunity to heal. Every day gives you an opportunity for forgiveness. When will I be completely in that place? When I'm there. I don't know.
Where are you in the forgiveness towards your ex-husband today?
You know, I, with my whole heart, wish him healing. Full healing, so that he can see the beauty in himself that I saw for so many years. Because I wanted him to heal so much, and I still do. He has so much love that he can give to his children and his family and his friends. There's a great guy. There's a great guy there. And I know that he can do it. And I always speak kindly to him. And I'm learning to speak more kindly about him. There's days when it's a challenge. But there's days when it's a challenge to speak kindly about the guy that cut me off in traffic, too. There's a little bit of a bafangu Italian in me, even though I don't have any Italian in my blood. You know, we all get angry. But we don't have to embrace anger. We can taste it like the salt on a chip. We don't have to eat the whole bag. And when I feel myself getting angry or feel myself getting aggressive, I always ask myself, am I turning out to be the best possible version of myself? I can't expect anybody else to change. I can change and hope and pray and send love to everybody. When someone comes into my mind, if I can't send them loving thoughts, it's time for me to dial in, because that's the only person I can change. I can't change anybody. I can't do it.
How are you feeling right now after having spent an hour conversation with me?
It was good. You know, the challenges were somewhat what I was expecting. The internet here has been sketchy. There's there's a small takeover here by another internet company, which means that they are literally cutting the lines. Literally, they're cutting the internet lines around me. I'm like, come on. And then I'm like, of course they are.
Yeah.
Of course they are, because then I can practice what I need to do, which is sometimes just relax.
Yeah.
Just relax. Yeah.
Well, with what time we do have left, again, I just wanted to acknowledge you and thank you for showing up and being present today. And I'd like to invite you, if you could be so kind, Nance, to share some closing thoughts, perhaps something that you could say that may be some guidance, some guiding light for another mom or dad that may be struggling with the loss of a child, and words of inspiration that you could maybe share about your healing journey and what that could look like for someone else. Like, what was the biggest things that helped you get to where you're at today, to where you could have a beautiful smile on your face and have this kind of conversation like we just had today?
You know, when we lose a child and we see a child that looks like ours, it's hard because we lose a part of ourselves when we lose a child. But when we can learn to see that child and the people around us, and we can learn to see the child within us, they're here. They are here. And whenever you think of them, they are thinking of you. And it's like that with people that are on this earth and in this energy vibration, and people that are of another vibration. When we think of somebody, they're thinking of us. They're never gone, and they're never forgotten. Always on our hearts and always on our minds. Stay in the feelings that you have and feel them. Feel them fully. Mm. If you want to cry, cry. Mm. And the tears always stop. And the heart heals slowly. Honor that in yourself. Honor that in yourself. And when someone says, or you hear yourself saying, you just need to get over it, you don't. You need to learn to live without their physical presence. You don't get over a death. You learn to live differently. Every Christmas is different. Every Valentine's Day is different. And you're never the same. You grow stronger. You grow stronger. Love and support from others is very important. And accepting it. Accepting it. And giving it. And giving it. And giving it. People need love and support when they go through grief. It's not 3 months. It's when everybody else forgets that it hurts. When everyone goes on living, and you don't know how. That's when support is needed the most. That's when it's needed the most. To learn to love again, to learn to trust, takes time. But kindness is always available. To yourself, to thine own self, right, be true. Honor your healing process and tell the truth about the way that you're feeling.
Mm. Yes.
If you're feeling like shit, say, you know what? I feel like shit. Say how you feel. Say what you mean. Say it. I'm having a shitty day and I don't want to go outside. I don't want to. No, thank you. Please call me tomorrow. And then when they ask you to call them tomorrow, call them back. Honor your words. Honor your promises. Call them back. And if you forget, they'll help you remember. They always do. You know, when the difference between when an angel is talking to you is when it's a soft, gentle whisper. Because they never yell. They never, ever yell. And they don't ever try to scare you either. It's always love. Always. Everybody was born beautiful and perfect. And that's what I've learned through forgiveness, is that the most despicable, dishonorable human being, somebody loves them somewhere. And everybody needs somebody to love them. And most of us need a little bit more. A little bit more. Less potato chips, more love. Sometimes.
Yes. Yes. Well, I think we've done about five hours. It's 5:09 right now. 5 hours. It's not 5 hours, but I want to just take a moment to thank those that joined us tonight, joined us this afternoon.
For your patience. Wow.
That joined us live and for commenting and hitting likes and loves. We've got John Thaddeus Fiore coming in from Jersey Shore of New Jersey. My sister coming in from Long Island, New York. We have Bronnie again coming in from Sydney, Australia. Kathy Wadalski. I don't recall, Kathy, where you're coming in from. Feel free to let us know. Gabrielle as well. Thank you for joining us today. And Donald Scherer coming in from Prescott, Arizona. I've got to learn how to say that appropriately. Anita Johnson, Kimberly Coons, thank you so much for being here today. And I think Heather Berger also, Waheed. We just had Gail Zimmerman come in as well. And I am just so grateful that we have people that show up that come into us live, and they also catch us on a replay. You're never too early, you're never too late. We just show up right on time. And so I'm going to ask if at some point in the next 24 hours, Nance, if you could maybe just take a moment just to acknowledge some people that have commented or asked any questions that come up. And I thank you so much for joining us live. I'm sorry on this day, Debbie did not make the show, that you and I did it alone. But, you know, that's all part of showing up today. You know, we never know when something's going to come up, and it's how we respond. And just understand that sometimes we just have to be willing. We always have to be willing to accept that we're just right where we're at. And whether it be in the moment or, you know, with people, places and things, it's coming to learn to embrace acceptance of it just is. It just is. And with that, I want to thank you again for coming on. I'm going to ask you if you stay in the studio when we head off the broadcast in a moment here, just for a second to do a wrap up off air. Thanks again for joining us this afternoon on Real People, Real Stories, Raw. I thought I was going to make it through today. We'll catch you next time. Thank you.